I think in the last class we have looked at how we could do a stack using a linked list. So today we will continue on that. Today what we'll do is, and I'll describe it first, we will implement a stack using an array. Which is better? This we discussed at length earlier. Stack is better when you are moving up and down. Array is better when you are moving up and down. Linked list is slow. That is, if you are going to access one element after another, that is, there is going to be a lot of pops or a lot of pushes, one after another. Then perhaps this array implementation is better. But can we visualize a scenario where a list is better in a stack? Well, not really, because a stack always has one way of retrieval. So perhaps what we did in the last session may not be the most optimal way of implementing a stack. We are better off implementing a stack from a performance point of view using an array. Of course, array has that inherent limitation that of fixed size, because array, whether you like it or not, has maximum capacity. And whether you allot, you may create an array of 10 elements or 100 elements, and you might end up using only 5. So the rest of the array gets unutilized, remains unutilized. That's not very good. And on the contrary, you may create an array of 100 elements, and you might find an occasion where I have to put 110 elements without popping any. And then, obviously, again, the stack using an array would not be an adequate implementation, because you would have to do an expansion and that things would get messy. So, if you are going to have an estimate of how many elements there are going to be, a rough estimate kind of, then I would go ahead and implement a stack using an array. Otherwise, if I don't have any idea about how many elements I am going to have in a stack, then I might as well use a linked list. So if it is indeterminate, you should use a linked list. If it is kind of determinate, then you should use an array. So we saw last time how to implement a stack using a linked list. You remember what we did? We added an element at the top, at the head, and then removed that element from the head. So a very simple manipulation of a linked list got us there. So today what we'll do is, we'll first try and implement a stack using an array. So once we are done with these couple of implementations, the next thing which we are going to do in this session, though not really in your syllabus, but we'll add it in your syllabus as we go, is what do you use a stack for? We will discuss at length later in third year. A lot of implementations, a lot of applications which use a stack. But even at this stage, I would like you to know that why the hell am I creating a stack? Why am I learning how to create a stack? Obviously, there are some textbook examples which are always there. Infix to postfix, postfix to evaluation. Those are kind of what you call canned explanations of stack applications. But a stack can be used for lot of applications, lots and lots of applications. So we will see at least a few of those in this session before we move on to the next data structure, which is Qt. Qt is very easy. So we will today implement the stack, look at one of the canned applications. We need to cover the canned canned means the standard textbook applications, and then we'll move on beyond that. So let's see how I can create a stack using an array. So I'll give you a insight, then you can go ahead and do it. So we will have class stack as usual, this time using an array as an implementation. So because I am going to use an array, and you know, array can be declared as a pointer also, or it can be declared as an array. So I would choose a pointer implementation. So int star ara. This is a pointer to the data which is there in the stack. I need that. And I would also need one more variable. This is important. Normally called top, which remembers, just like in a linked list implementation, did we not have a head pointer? So the head pointer kept track of where we are, I mean the head of the stack, head of the linked list. So we could add elements there and we could get elements out from there. So the head, the maintaining of the HPTR was crucial for a stack. So like that, for an array, we need to keep track of a variable which we normally call int top. This keeps track of the top of the stack, top of the array, which element of the array we are going to use, because the array may have many elements, but we always take element from the top and push element to the top. That's what we do. So we need a variable like top. This is not tap, please, though it is looking like that. It is top. And we have a, all this is public. Let's keep everything public. Then we have a constructor here. So stack constructor. Just like in case of the linked list, we could have passed a parameter which gives the size of the potential stack. I don't know whether we did that, but we could have done that. So int l. So the constructor for the stack takes a estimate of the length of the stack as a parameter. That is, at any given time, how many elements are going to be pushed into the stack without being popped. That will give you how many elements do I need to hold in the stack, isn't it? In the array. That will give a rough estimate of the size of the array. So what will I do here? I will say arr is equal to, now I need to set this pointer to that memory. So I will say new int square bracket l. Everybody with me on this line? So I just noticed my handwriting is going from bad to worse. Okay. Means I am getting smarter. So arr is equal to new int l. This does what? It creates a stack, or it creates an array of a particular size. Now the size is an estimate, so I will go with that estimate. Obviously, if you don't estimate correctly, you will have an underutilization or an overutilization issue. So I am assuming that we know kind of how big the stack should be maximum. This is one, and notionally I will say top equal to minus one, because currently there is no element of the stack. If there was even one element of the stack, I would have said top equal to 0. Because top points to the top of the stack. That is, this is where I will pop the element from. That gives me the top. This is conventionally done. So this is top. Okay. Now, assuming that I have given you a constructor, and let's say we stick with this constructor. Let's assume, or let's pretend, that we don't want to change the constructor. This is the constructor. So the constructor takes L as a parameter, which is an estimate of the length of the stack, allocates an array big enough to hold that many numbers, integers in this case, and also makes a variable top equal to minus 1. Top is used to keep track of the top of the stack, like HPTR in case of a linked list, right? So now what happens? Now we need to implement two operations, right? Push and pop. We are doing the push and pop way, we are not doing the pop and top, which we saw. Anyway, once you know how to do this, you can do that also. So, we will do a push operation. So, how do we implement a push operation? So, in a push operation, there is perhaps one more thing which we want to keep in this stack. Can you tell me which one? Any suggestions, something else we would like to keep in the state of the stack? We have two variables, an array pointer and a top. Do you think we should keep something else? Current length, right? How much of the stack is actually getting used? We call it C length. We did that with the linked list implementation also. It tells us currently what is the size of the stack. Okay. So let's add a variable int C length, which will keep track how many elements are actually getting used. So, let me add one more variable here called int c length, current length, you can call it whatever you want. And what would I do here? I would say c length equal to 0. Okay. of you created here itself, fine, but I am writing a constructor, so that this L comes in. Okay, so I have a variable C length equal to 0. So now I need to write a push, and let's say I will be consistent with what we did earlier. If push is successful, it returns a value which was pushed, otherwise it gives a minus 1. So push int v, the value which needs to be pushed. So what should be the body of the push? How should we start? First of all, what is the first thing we take? Obviously. Do we have space in our stack as far or not? That's at most first thing that we would like to check, isn't it? Have we reached capacity? So the first thing we would like to do is we would like to say if C length already equal length or whatever that we are keeping there. We should have kept another variable for max length, isn't it? No, yes. Otherwise you wouldn't know. Unless we keep that variable, we should maintain one more variable called size or capacity. Let's do that. So, I am just making it very simple because here, I have to be worried about the memory. Okay. So, we will say, I will create a variable int capacity and I will say capacity is equal to L. So, my capacity is equal to L, my top is minus 1 which keeps track of the element. So, we are getting ready to write a push. Okay, so first line, as somebody said, we should say if C length equal capacity. If C length is already reached capacity, then obviously we can't do anything about it. We have to say we can give a C out here or the caller can give a C out. Either way is fine. So we can say return a minus 1. Okay? And in the calling program, we will see if it is a minus 1, we will say stack is full. It's okay, it doesn't matter. This could be also put here as a line. Okay? It's up to us. Okay. Now, assuming that we have not reached capacity, what should we do? So, what should we do? We need to move an element into the stack, right? So, we can't use top as it is. Top was supposed to be used as an index into the array to keep track of where we are, how much of the array we have used, what is the current index in the array which is there. Imagine the array in your mind. So, the top is right now minus 1. It's nowhere. When you add the first element, our top is going to go up. And with every element, the top is going to keep going up. Right? So, if I have to add an element, I have to first increment top. Okay, you could do that with a pre-increment operator also. And put that element in that particular slot of top. So you could do it in one line or you could do it in two lines. So you could also say, for example, if you choose to do it in one line, what would you say? You would say ARR bracket, square bracket, plus plus top equal to whatever the value that we are trying to put in the stack. So V. So that would be, so we have achieved two things. We have incremented our top and we have also put the value in the stack. We have done that. What else do we need to do? So we need to increment our C length to C length plus 1. Correct? That's it. Would you agree? Do you have to do anything else? No. It's far more simpler than working with the linked list, isn't it? No pointers, no less of pointers. So let's write that. Let's continue writing that. I don't have space there, so we'll continue this in the next page. Okay. So continuing with push. Okay, let me write push again. Int push int v. So what I do here is I first check if C length is equal to capacity. I say it return minus 1. Okay.
Then, the fact that it has come here means the capacity is not reached, otherwise it would return right there. So, I would then do ARR plus plus tau is equal to V. So, I have put in this value. First, I incremented the tau, increase the subscript, and then put the value there. So, tau has very conveniently got incremented. Okay. So, we have the value sitting in the stack. What do we do after this? So, we say C length is equal to C length plus 1. That's it. Anything else you need to do? Top has been already incremented, the value is sitting in the stack, in the array, and we're done. Anything else you would like to do? Yes, no? Would you like to do anything else? We incremented C length, so we know what is the current length has gone up. So, now, int pop. What should pop do? What should it do? First thing, what should it do? First, you have to check whether pop is a legitimate operation or not, isn't it? So, if you can say top equal equal minus 1, or an easier thing is, you can do that also. Or you can say if C length equal to 0. If C length equal to 0, that means there is absolutely no element in the stack. So, what are you popping for? You can't pop. So, again, you say return minus 1, or as we saw, the alternative is, you can give a message and then return minus. Everybody with me on that? Very simple, no? What is it? Either I have it or I don't have it. If I don't have it, C length tells me. I don't have it. I don't have any element. So you are not going to be able to pop it. Okay? So that's the first line. That is what we call the guard. The guard code. When I say the guard code, it means that check the sanity of the operation. You will see this often. When you write a function or write some code, first, you check the parameters. Are they fine? Can this be done? So, right at the top, you say the guard code, and it's very correct way of writing. I will not allow the code to fall through unless it has passed through the guard. Right? So, let's say it has passed through the guard, which means that C length is more than 1, and top is not minus 1. Right? So, what do I do now? So, one line. So, I have to do two things. I have to decrement the top and I have to give back that value. Right? I can do one thing before that. I can do C length is equal to C length minus 1. Right? Because the current size of my stack is going to diminish. We don't delete elements. This is integers. No? So, why would you delete an integer? We already allocated memory for everything. So, simply deleting, memory is already gone based on the size of the stack. See, we don't allocate memory every time. That would be catastrophic. That if you want to do that, you would use a linked list. Where every time we allocate a node. Okay? Now, we want speed. So, we have allocated the whole stack. Okay. So, what we will do here is, we will check first. I'll try and write it here. If C length equal 0, then I return minus 1. I don't want to proceed. Else, anyway, I don't need to write an else. So I say C length is equal to C length minus 1. I do it first. Then I say return what? ARR minus minus tau. Would that do the trick? I am doing a pre-decrement on top because top needs to come down and I am returning that value. Or this won't work, right? Why it won't work? I have to first take the top value and do. So what should I do? First take the value and then decrement, correct? No, yes. I shouldn't be doing this because I want the topmost element. So I should be doing this. Take the value, return that value, and then decrement top. Don't decrement first top. That way you won't get the top of the array. You want the top of the array, and after that you want top to go down. Or if you want to make life simple, instead of not doing this, just say top is equal to top minus 1 and return top. Sorry, I messed it up. First retrieve the top value, put it in some V, and then decrement top. Am I right? Are you understanding why I have to first retrieve the value sitting at top and then decrement top? Just imagine, I have one element. If I have one element, where will top be? Top will be 0. Correct. One element will make top equal to 0. Because remember, you started with a minus 1. So, top will be 0, that means one element. When I take that off, I have to get out the value of the first element, which is 0. The 0th element, I have to get that. And after that, I have to make top minus 1. And the value I have to give back is the value I got at that slot. So, if you don't want to complicate your life, you can do it that way in two lines. I normally recommend that you should do it in two lines. While putting element in the stack, if you look at the top line, first you need to increment and then put it in the slot. Because remember, top is starting with minus 1. Just remember that. So you have to first increment it and then move the value in that slot. So it's a pre-increment but post-decrement. If you want. Otherwise, you just write it on a separate line. You don't want that mess. You don't want to think it that way. Just write two lines instead of one. So, this is what is our stack. This is what we are going to use with the stack. So, let's see whether we can make our stack work. Actually, I'll pause for 5-10 minutes. So, you make a stack work. How do you test whether the stack is working or not? You need a main, right? So, you need to write a main where you have to say push. First create the stack, write 4 push statements, try to do 5 pops, see whether you get a minus 1 at the end. Or if you want, you can change the push itself, you can say stack full, and pop you can say stack empty. That would make life much more easy. Okay. Instead of just returning minus 1, you do that, plus you also declare there if you have a situation. You need to implement, which practice question is this? Or we don't have anything. Then let's see the main. Open that question. Go to students. Let's see whether we can make use of it. While one. Okay, you're giving pop, push. So you can write the display also. So take this exercise and do it. So you have to implement a stack with appropriate methods, push, pop, and display. Display just displays the underlying stack. Is that clear? Just the underlying stack, whatever is there, has to be displayed. The example will help you, the test case. We'll pause for 10 minutes, let's see. You just take this display. Don't write your own display. Just take this display and write it. Write your own push and pop. That's all. Use this display. This is what will pass. I think we should stop the question so that people don't get distracted and open it so that they can do it in the home. Now we are going to do one application, which is an application of a stack. Okay? Imagine stack is already there. Now you can do it this way. You can borrow the stack from C++ library. I showed you, right, last time. It can be a stack of int, it can be a stack of char, it can be a stack of anything, okay? Writing loops, writing simple programs like finding factorial, doing basic recursion, all of that. Normally at this time, this kind of class gets more charged up. I'm seeing the same thing with your immediate senior. So, what we will do is,
we will write an application which uses a standard. Now, conventionally, the standard application is infix to postfix and then evaluation of postfix. We will do that. But before that, let's do two or three applications of our own and then go to the standard application, what we call the textbook application or classic application. So, here is the example. So, you are given a brackets expression. So, let's open that question for a moment. Which one? Braces balance question, we have opened it. Let's open the, let's see the question and then I'll explain what the question is. And you have to do it only using a stack. Okay, don't use something else. So, the expression is, okay, go up. You will be given a string like this. Can you see that string? Okay. It has three kinds of braces. The parenthesis, the curly brace, which we call the flower bracket, and the square bracket. Is there any other kind of brace? As far as I know, there are only three kinds, right? Sorry? No. Any other? No. On to the outside. Okay. Square bracket. Flower bracket and parenthesis. Now, look at that expression. It starts with two flower brackets. Starting is not a problem. Now, if you see this, if you see the expression which is given, it is kind of balanced. Now, why is it balanced? When we say a bracket is balanced or braces are balanced, when for every closing brace, there is a corresponding opening brace. I think anybody, even with the stupor you are in, will understand that you can't close a bracket which has never been opened. First you open a bracket and then you can close it. That is called a legitimate closure. Yes? Otherwise it's an illegal closure. Right? You're closing what? Like what you didn't open, you can't close. So, if you see the first expression, you have open bracket, open curly bracket, and obviously, so there are two rules. You can't close a bracket without opening it, and you can't close a bracket which was opened with a parenthesis with a corresponding square bracket. Oh, yes. Obviously, if you encounter a square bracket, you should have a corresponding opening bracket at the top. So, the first expression appears to be balanced. So you display something called braces are balanced. That is, there is no imbalance. Whatever was opened only has been closed. And there are not more closures than there are openers. But if you look at the second expression, it opened fine. There was a curly bracket, there was a square bracket, and there was a parenthesis. It should have been closed with a parenthesis. How can an open bracket, open parenthesis, be closed by a square bracket? Do you understand the problem there? See, the fourth character in that string is the square bracket. Can you see there? Now that's illegal. You can't do that. Everybody agrees? You should close the parenthesis with a parenthesis. I mean, the closing parenthesis, and then move on. So that's illegal. So the answer which this string should produce is braces are imbalanced, right? Or not balanced. So now, do you understand this or recognize this as a good application to do with a stack? No, yes. Do you see this as a potential stack? We could use a stack for doing this. It would be easy, no? Because the natural structure of the stack would allow you to check. So, okay. So let's write a stack for the top portion first. And then I'll just describe how you do. So, here we go. Let me start with this. How will the stack look? Acha. You will read in a string. Okay. You know how to read in a string? See in, declare a big string and read the string. Once you read in the string, do you know how to go character by character in a string? String is an array of characters, right? And till you reach a \0, you can keep going through that string, right? No, yes. How do you go through a string? Character by character, right? So, your first character you are going to get is this. So, what are you going to do? Whenever you get an opening bracket, any kind of opening bracket, just push it into the stack. So, at this moment my stack is this. Here, what is my stack? This. I am at the second character. Whenever I get an opening bracket, just don't think. Just push it onto the stack. That is the character which is at the yes. Now remember, we are going to use the C++ stack. C++ stack has two operations or three. One is of course the push, but do you understand or do you remember there is a top operation and a pop operation? What is the difference? Top will show you what is at the top without removing it. It's only the pop which will get rid of the last character. Do you remember that? Top will not remove the character. Top will only show you what is the last character. So, now, where are we? We are here. So, now I got an open parenthesis. So, I am at the open parenthesis. Again, I am at the another open parenthesis. So, there are two of those. So, I get open parenthesis. Okay, now, look at this. I am here. I got a closed parenthesis. So, what will I do? I will examine the top of the stack. Okay, I will examine the top of the stack. Now, I will examine the top of the stack only when I get any closed story. Whenever I get an open bracket of any kind, whether it's a curly bracket or it's a square bracket or it's a parenthesis, what will I do? I'll not use my mind so much. I'll just push it into the stack. Because if you have a curly bracket, you just have to push it into the stack, open bracket, right? Any open bracket, push it into the stack. Now when you get a closed bracket, that is where we need to check. So, now, when I get this, I look at the top of the stack. Right? What is the top of the stack in this case? The top of the stack is this. Does it match? So, the top of the stack, right now, what do I have with me? Open bracket. What is the top of the stack? Sorry. What do I have with me is a closed parenthesis. So, the top of the stack should be an open parenthesis. Only then it will match. Does it happen like that? Yes. The top of the stack is an open parenthesis. Okay? So in that case, what do? I pop it. This goes off. And I move on. This is fine. I move on. I don't give an error. Okay? So, now I come here. What happens now? Again, what happens now is, I am having a closed parenthesis. Whenever there is a closed parenthesis or closed bracket of any kind, I examine the top of the stack. Do I see a correspondence? Yes, I do. See, there is a close of the parenthesis here and there is an open parenthesis here. So, I knock this off. I pop this. Only when I examine it, I pop it. So, I am gone with this. Right? Then what do I do? So, I am now here. No error so far. I am fine. So, I am here. I am at this square bracket. So, again I have a closing square bracket. So, I should examine the top. So, I have correspondingly an opening square bracket, which is nice. So, I can knock it off and move forward. So, again I have a closing square bracket. Again I look at the top of the stack. I am fine. This is a closing, opening square bracket. This is a closing. So, I knock it off. I am fine again. Now, I reach this flower bracket, curly bracket. So, since it's a curly flower closing bracket, I have to look at the top of the stack. Do I have a corresponding opening of a flower bracket? I do. Yes? No problem. I knock it off. Move forward. I am on the last character now. So I have knocked this off. Closing bracket. So I examine the top of the stack. Do I have a corresponding opening bracket of that kind? Yes, I have. Knocked the stack. I have reached the end of the string. Now if your expression is perfectly balanced, how should your stack be at the end? All the closers would have knocked out your openers, right? No, yes. So the stack should be completely empty at the end of it. If you reach the end of the string and your stack is not empty, you have a problem.
That means you have an extra bracket somewhere or a bunch of extra brackets somewhere which are not matching. There are no closures to those, right? You have an extra opening bracket. That's what it means. You agree with me? So at that point we say, no, they are not balanced, right? So at the end of the string, if you manage to reach the end of the string, everything should be empty. The opener should have knocked out the closures, okay? Or I should say the closures should have knocked out the openers, right? Agree with me? No. It's very intuitive, isn't it? Okay. Now let's look at the second string and what happens with that second string, right? Let's look at the second string. And let's see how the stack gets used to solve this. So, what happens with the flower bracket? It's an opening bracket, so no questions asked, goes into the stack. Opening bracket, no questions asked, goes into the stack. Again, an opening bracket, no questions asked, goes into the stack. Then, I have a closing bracket. What kind of closing bracket? Square bracket. And what do I have now? Because it's a closing bracket, I ought to examine the top of the stack. What do I have? I have an anomaly. I'm looking for a... What kind of bracket I'm looking for? I'm looking for a opening square bracket. And instead, what do I get? I get an opening parenthesis. I have an anomaly. At this point, I just flash an error. You can terminate the code here itself and say brackets are imbalanced. Obviously, you have a closure with no corresponding opener. Doesn't work. So you can declare it here itself that the expression is imbalanced from its bracket perspective. Correct? So you need to give this error. That is all you need to do. So this is an interesting application of a stack, a very common again, but not a classic textbook kind of thing. Is everybody clear what I am asking you to do? You have to use a stack. What would you create this stack? Stack of integers or stack of something else? Ideally, you should create a stack of characters, because each character, each bracket is a character, isn't it? So you would create a stack of characters. Now, how would you do that? Look at the documentation, or it's simply stack, angular bracket. Oh, I forgot about the angular bracket, sorry. There's another pair of brackets called the angular bracket. Anyway, we are not coming in our question. So stack, angular bracket, char, ST. That's how you do? I'm saying use the C++ stack, don't use your own stack. Okay? Nothing wrong about using your stack, but you don't have a top and a pop operation. Top is also called like a peak operation. It's called, in Java, we call it a peak. We're just peaking at it, not getting rid of it. So, a lot of other languages call it peak. First peak, then pop. Okay. Here, it is called only pop. The way we wrote is pop. In C++, there's a top and a pop. Top doesn't destroy the stack. It just tells you what is the element at the top of the stack. We have started it. Let's see whether you can do it. You just have to. Main is given, please. Don't do anything with the main. You just need to write. Can you go up? You just need to write a Boolean value. You just need to write this method. Given a string. Inside that you can create a stack and do all that. Just need to write this method. So just fill it up. Don't write your main, don't do anything. Just write the method rbalanced. Or rbalanced braces. Use a string. String is a C++ string. I think we'll keep the question open. So you can, those of you who want to continue, can continue.